It's John Bussey. I'm with the Wall Street Journal. I'm delighted to be presiding at today's council event. Our subject is the emerging role of China's economy. It's probably the next phase of the emergence of China's economy. You don't go in 37 years from being off the grid to the world's second largest economy without some bumps along the road, and we'll describe some of those and explore some of those today. You know, is the China miracle over? Are the days of faster growth gone for good? Can the transition that China's economy needs to now make be done without instability domestically or in some way destabilizing the global economy? We'll get into some of those subjects over the next hour and 10 minutes. We have a fabulous panel of experts to hear from today. Xinli was one of the architects of China's current reform program. Xiqing was the former president of the China Investment Corporation, the very large sovereign wealth fund, the fourth largest in the world. David Lee is an economist, an advisor to the leadership in China with in Tsinghua University, which is a partner with the council for this event, I should add. And Nick Lardy, many of you know, is with the Peterson Institute, an expert on the Chinese economy and has written widely on it. Just a couple of housekeeping notes. We'll have simultaneous interpretation for Mr. Jun's comments and any other comments that are made in Mandarin in the course of the proceedings. You should have your devices there to hear. If you could put your cell phones on mute or stun, something that doesn't kind of interrupt the proceedings, that would be much appreciated. This is on the record, and when you are asking questions later on, if you would just please identify yourself. So what we'll do is we'll have 10 minutes of opening remarks from Mr. Chun, describing the council has asked him to address what are the three big challenges that are facing the Chinese economy, but he'll also be able to update us a bit on where this reform effort stands. Then we'll go to our panel discussion, which will react to Mr. Jun's comments, but also add to them for about 30 minutes, and then we'll have 30 minutes of Q&A at the end. So with that, please welcome Mr. Jun to the stage.
Ladies and gentlemen, good afternoon.
Thanks.
Happy to have this opportunity to talk about the Chinese economy and the development of Sino-U.S. economic cooperation, the outlook for its future development. Happy to have this opportunity to share my views. Rapid development in China has been experienced over the past three decades. To date, there are three major challenges that are faced. The first, insufficient demand, or you could say overcapacity of supply. Over the past 30 years, there's been a very high rate of investment. It's gone from 30% to 50% investment as proportion of GDP. And consumption has dropped from 50% to just 35%. We have seen an ongoing investment and expansion of capacity, production capacity, whereas consumption demand has not kept up with that rapid increase in supply. So now, no matter what you produce, it's difficult to sell. Over the past 30 years of reform and opening, the challenges that we have addressed have been very focused on immediate difficulties. Now we have to think about deeper, longer-term structural issues in terms of supply and demand balances. That's the first challenge, supply and demand. Second challenge is downward pressure on the overall economy. for the past 4 years consecutively, we've seen a deceleration of economic growth in China. It's the first half of this year, GDP year-on-year growth was 7%. But these four consecutive years of downward pressure has led to an overall feel of deceleration. Third, deflation. Our CPI has, for the last 14 months, been decreasing. This dampens investor enthusiasm, and leads to deflation and negative or underwhelming economic forecasts. So these are the three major challenges I think faced by the Chinese economy. What is behind these difficulties? I think over the past several years, in terms of monetary policy, we've seen very relatively tight. The growth of M2 money supply from 2011 to 2014 had an average growth of 13.5%. In the first half of this year, M2 growth dropped to 11.8%. From 1991 to 2011, this 20-year period, the average annual growth of M2 money supply was 20.5%. At a time when the average GDP growth was 10.3%. So M2 growth was about twice the growth of GDP. So this is an interesting economic phenomenon. In the meets the Freeman curve, in the 1990s, when inflation was high and economic growth was very quickly, I came and spoke to Freeman in the U.S., and he had noted the experience of Taiwan, Korea, other economies, where M2 growth maintained at a rate of about twice that of GDP, which is normal. So China once again corroborates that ratio, the relationship between M2 and GDP. But because of the challenges that I just mentioned, those three challenges, we can say that these are kind of objective results of macroeconomic policy. Only with the correct monetary policy can further sustained economic growth be sustained. Compare our experience to the U.S. U.S. has a per capita GDP that is 6 times that of China's. Consumption is also twice, consumer spending is also twice that of China's. One American, a single Chinese person spends 1/10 of that of an American. So it's very clear that the challenges that are sprouting up now are the results of policy, structural policy deficiencies. Further reform and correct policy rebalancing can certainly provide the potential for ongoing robust economic growth. At the third plenary of the 18th Party Congress, we heard about the plans for deepening comprehensive reforms in China. It's already been over a year, and of the 130 reforms that were listed, the majority of them were economic reforms. These reforms perhaps are different than those of the past. What we are seeing now is reforms that are talked about in a systematic and top-down approach, as opposed to the kind of bottom-up pilot experiments that were done in reforms of the past decades. Now, over the past year or so since that third plenary meeting, a number of implementation plans have been raised to the State Council and are being assessed and prepared for implementation to see whether they are in line with the spirit of the third plenary session. If they are inconsistent with that spirit, they are sent back for revision. There have already been a number of these implementing plans that are seen as mature and being prepared to implement. This includes reforms aimed at releasing authority down to lower levels and streamlining approval processes, opening markets. Also includes opening for the banking industry, allowing more participation from small and medium-sized banks. It also addresses a very serious issue, which is the rural land reform. Three types of land that are both agricultural, collective farmer land, and land that has use rights but not ownership rights are subject to new land reform proposals. Allowing these reforms would allow farmers or rural residents to take a financial ownership of the land and engage in transactions based on that on those assets. This would allow for the consolidation and therefore the mechanization of agriculture, increase productivity in rural China. We know that there are over 280 million farmers in working in the agricultural sector in China. There children have, there are 40 million of their children and 40 million of spouses of farmers that are not working. So all told, we're talking it up to close to between 350 and 400 million people. If we are able to empower them financially using the land as an agricultural asset, then this could unleash a tremendous power in the economy. Another reform is the reform of state-owned enterprises. According to the third plenary of the 18th Party Congress, we need to move from an asset-based to a capital-based public finance management model. This includes the creation of hybrid public-private ownership models in which private sector practices are introduced into public entities. Also allow for employee share ownership and management-level share ownership for public, for state-owned enterprise. And these are all proposals that are being developed. Not all of the implementing measures have been released, but the vision is very clear, and it's certain that these reforms will come to take formation in policy. Also, financial reform is also coming out on a regular basis. All of these reforms are focused on having the market play a decisive role in the allocation of resources in the economy. allowing the market to play its full role in China's economy. Now, the implementation of the third plenary spirit, some people are anxious. They think that it's taking too long. There's even doubts, will it be implemented? But this, I would ask you all to have faith. When the central government identifies a clear vision for reform, it will be implemented. It is maybe a matter of time, but I assure you it is a matter of when, not of if. I would also take a moment to speak about economic cooperation between China and the U.S. Over the past 30 years or so, economic cooperation between China and the U.S. has been critical for the development of China. But the old model of cooperation is perhaps ready for a change based on the comparative differences between China and the U.S. today. For example, the comparative differences between industry in China and the U.S., it used to be a completely vertical separation of labor. Now we are moving towards a horizontal collaboration. In the past, it was about U.S. capital moving into China. Now we are moving towards a bi-directional investment flow, especially with all of the treasury debt that China has bought, over $1 trillion. Some of that has to be converted into equity rather than just debt. Also, in terms of technology, in the past, technology was brought from the U.S. into China. Now China is looking to develop its indigenous innovation capacities. For example, China's applications for patents since last year has already surpassed that of the U.S. We are the largest patent applicant country in the world. In 2010, the U.S. had 6 times as many patents as China. In 2011, it was 3.8 times. In 2012, it was 2.8 times. In 2013, it was 2.5 times as many. That gap has been narrowing and has been closed. Collaboration in the future is going to rely on an investment protection treaty, or a BIT, a bilateral investment treaty. And we hope that in this year's visit from Xi Jinping, we can see real progress towards signing such a BIT. And we also need a BITT, adding a T for investment and trade. And third, signing an FTA, a free trade agreement between the U.S. and China. We know that the U.S. already has an FTA with Korea. I would love to see an FTA become a topic for future U.S.-China relations. And we would also like to see the U.S. helping China into the TPP and China helping the U.S. into the RACP, these multilateral trade frameworks. These would be adhesives that bring our countries closer together and allow for greater cohesion as we seek to deepen our cooperation. I think standing together, cooperating, these two countries, tied by a common bond, will certainly find prosperity. That's all the time I have for now, but thank you very much.
So Nick Lardy, Mr. Jordan just described a rather ambitious transformation. He talked about deregulation, about opening the private sector, about the reform of the SOEs. The American business sector doesn't really quite see it that way. It sees a lot of industrial policy. It sees still very strong SOEs standing in the way of investment in China. It sees anti-monopoly laws. It sees indigenous innovation drives. Can you square the circle for us? Are we underestimating how much privatization is happening in China and the strength of the private sector?
Well, I think, you know, it's a complicated situation. You can point to examples that would support different points of view, but when I look at the aggregate data, I think it's very clear that the private sector has been driving economic growth in China for a long time. Yes, there are industrial policy. The state, yes, has complete control of very important parts of the service sector, upstream oil and gas, and a few other things, but most of the rest of the economy, the private sector dominates in terms of output, in terms of employment, and also in terms of investment. We just got the first half numbers from the Statistical Bureau. 65% of all investment in China in the first half was undertaken by private firms. So the state has become smaller, but it is still dominant in a few sectors. Now, I'd also like to make a couple of comments on the challenges that Mr. Zheng outlined. I would say that the downward pressure is not shouldn't be thought of as entirely a challenge. In some way, it should be welcomed, because it is primarily because of a moderation in the growth of investment in property. China had been over-investing in property for quite some time. 2010, before the downward pressure, property investment was growing at 33%. Then it was 28. Then it was something in the mid-20s. Then it was 18. Last year, it was 10. This year, it's probably going to be 4 or 5. And that has dragged down industrial growth, steel, electric power, and everything else. But China had been massively over-investing in property, so this was a correction that had to come sooner or later, and of course, in the nature of things, sooner is always better. So, yes, it's a challenge, but it is also, I think, a positive development. And then the other one, I'll come back to it later, but on deflation, yes, deflation is an issue in China, but it's not the kind of issue you'd expect to see in many economies. First of all, China's still growing at 7%. I don't think it's likely to slip to 3, 4, or 5.
That's a real number that you can trust, that 7%?
We can go into that, yes. Deflation is not a problem in an economy that's growing at the mid-single digits or greater. And investment is still too high. Deflation, Mr. Zheng said, is leading to more caution on investment. But China's still investing way too much. And so I do not share his assessment that monetary policy has been too tight. If we're going to rebalance this economy and move even more towards consumption and away from investment, we need a continuation of moderately tight monetary policy. And deflation, third reason I'm not so worried about deflation is that it is in significant part due to declines in global commodity prices, so that China's importing deflation.
Mr. Gao, we heard a lot of structural description, very big, broad themes, and yet we have episodic events as well in China that we take note of. Notably, between November and a few weeks ago, the stock market had run up over 100%. Now you've seen that burn off in what's being called a crash, but it's only a fifth or fourth of the market has come down. So people have made a lot of money since last November, but there's a sense of a kind of a reverse wealth effect. There's a crash undergoing in China. There's government intervention in the markets. You were, among other things, a securities regulator. What do you make of this? Is it just an episodic event, or is it a sign of financial instability in China that we should be more concerned about?
Well, there are bifurcating trends there and very different views right now. Because the one thing interesting about China today is that the views are so diverse now than ever in the past 60 years of China's history. Because not China's history, PRC history, that people, the first time you can see 50% people voting for one side and 50 on the other side. Now, the same is true with this so-called market crash. I don't see so much of a problem as the reduction of the market value, which people say, oh, we lost 20 trillion yuan market worth, but 20 trillion yuan, in put it in perspective, it's only one third of the market. And also, as you just pointed out, most people who claim that they lost everything, lost their shirt, is actually want to say, well, when did you get in? You know, the problem, of course, is this small group, I mean, small, you know, by Chinese standards, a small group of people, they say 20,000 accounts of people with over 5 million yuan lost their shirts. Yeah, they said, well, that we wiped out the middle class. I said, middle class in China is about 20 million. So 20,000 is a very, very small number there. So I don't worry as much about the number itself, but I worry a lot more about the way it, you know, how it happened and how you deal with it. Mm. That's why recently there has been so much debate on why would the government come in. People have this term, which is called saving the market by violence. It's a 暴力救市. And it's actually spelled out as a positive thing. Many people, they say, well, yeah, the government needs to use violence to save the market because there's that much of a panic in the market. And I saw the panic, especially those 2 days, because every day I'm still, you know, I still try to get a free lunch at the CIC. So I go there and all these people at the CIC, so everyone's like, oh my God, you know, do you know what happened? I said, you know, it's, by looking at the number, I don't see that much of a problem. I said, well, there's a lot of panic. Why? Simply because of two things. One, the kind of a leverage people use. Because by, you know, I didn't understand what that leverage. I said, our law is so strict that leverage is only, the margin is only allowed up to 50%. So, and it's no, it's actually coming down to about 10 or even 5%. Very much like what happened in 1929 in this country. Why is that? Simply because, you know, we have different regulators, and the stock market regulators don't care about that much because much of the money that's landed for the margin is outside of the securities regulation, and it's all from the banking side. It's all the banking side. It's their problem, and we want to encourage people to come into the market. And in fact, if you read the newspaper in those days and official website, all of them are saying, oh, we are going to have a state bull market. And it's more or less sponsored by the government to say, OK, everyone getting in. Mm. That, to me, was a big concern because, you know, people complain that during the years of Zhu Rongji, we also had certain people's daily articles talking about the market. I said, no, there's a huge difference because even though at the time I wasn't for it, at least twice during Zhu Rongji's time, we came out and said, well, the market is way too high. This is what we would call irrational exuberance of the market, so be careful. You know, when you say that, some people get nervous. But this time, the first time, the government comes out and said, oh, the market is too low, let's all go in, the market is not going to come down. And then, of course, a lot of people get in, you know, the sort of mentality there. So I think that's an issue. When you actually state-sponsored bull market.
Right. We would never have that here. We would have a Fed-sponsored bull market. We don't call it a state-sponsored. Mr. Lee, Mr. Zheng talked about deceleration and metabolizing in the economy all of these changes that are happening and seem to suggest that some of the deceleration is as a result of the natural organic process of the kind of rapid and rather large changes that are going on in China. How long will the slowdown last? Give us your sense of the trajectory before yes. China's economy picks up.
Wonderful question. I think many investors are very concerned about this issue. But before answering you, I can't help but making a side comment. I was shocked. I am still shocked by the small size of the room. I claim the CFR must have the world's largest ratio of reputation divided by physical space. In fact, this is our mission. Our mission of Tsinghua University to come here is to learn from CFR. So together with me, we have many, many colleagues and entrepreneurs from China, right? I don't have time to introduce one by one. Okay, anyway, also I'm very happy to see some of our old friends, colleagues, Robert Garris from the Schwarzman Scholars Program, of which I'm the dean. So nowadays, I'm pushed to spend 100% of my energy in the Schwarzman Scholars Program, who lives next door from here. I guess, I was told, not too far from here, right? So if I don't see things coherently, blame Stephen Schwarzman. Okay, that's where advertisement of Stephen Schwarzman's work program. Admissions will end very soon. Okay, call your young friends to apply. Okay. Anyway, so very important question: when will the slowdown end? According to our analysis, we did a careful analysis. We strongly believe by the end of this year, perhaps the latest, the first half of next year, this big cycle of slowing down started 4 years ago will perhaps end. The trough will be reached in the coming half year, at most 1 year. That is, the economic growth rate will be stabilized just perhaps short of 7%. Why is that? Because I fully agree with Nick's point. Because the current slowing down is mainly driven by the slow growth of fixed asset investment, which accounts for 40%, even more, 45% of the GDP. And within the fixed asset investment, the biggest chunk is property market investment, which usually accounts for 28% of fixed asset investment. But now we're beginning to see early signs of recovery of fixed asset investment in the property market. Why? Because in the first tier and second tier cities, we have already been watching month on month, for example, May versus April, this past May, increase of property price, also sales volume. As a consequence, the inventory of property in this first tier and some of second tier cities is coming down. So according to our historical pattern, the investment in property market will recover. Okay, so therefore, my call, okay, you can call me 6 months, 1 year, maybe I'm wrong, okay? Okay, so my call is that in the coming 6 months, the GDP slowing down will be stabilized. But the issue is, when will the economy stay at the bottom? Will it further sliding down or will it recover? Also, based on our research, I strongly argue that the economy, after staying at the bottom, will recover in terms of GDP growth rates in the coming 3, 4, 5 years. We don't know, depending on the pace of reform. So therefore, we are reaching the bottom of a big U. I hope the bottom is not too wide, maybe as narrow as 1 year or a few months.
What's GDP growth rate at the bottom?
At the bottom, just below 7%, around 7%, you know, depending on how you count it. Because, by the way, the Chinese GDP is much more difficult to measure nowadays than before, because it's a fundamental structural change. The traditional sectors like iron and steel and cement are slowing down. However, there are exciting new sectors. Actually, sitting with us, we have private entrepreneurs like Mr. Zheng. Mr. Zheng sitting here. He's been doing lots of investments.
Walk us through what happens on the other side of the U. What takes China's economy back up? What fires the economy?
Three new engines of growth have to be fired up, kickstart, right? First engine of growth is urbanization, which we're still not reaping the benefit.
Slightly over half of China is urbanized.
Exactly.
Lots more to urbanize.
Exactly. Even the half of the population which supposedly have been urbanized are not really urbanized, because many of the people living in cities do not have living permits, resident permits, not enabling them not to be able to buy a car or buy an apartment. So they are not part of the city. They are like almost like illegal immigrants in New York City, right? They live under fear, okay? So that's the first engine of growth. Second engine of growth I call greening up of the industrial capacity. Let me give you one quick example. In Beijing, our sky, frankly speaking, is not as blue as New York City. Why? Because nearing Beijing, we have 300 million tons of steel production every day going on. The sky cleaned up only before the APEC last November, when the production stopped to welcome your president among many leaders of the world, right? So that production capacity has to be greened up. And in the process, there will be lots of investments. If China spends 1 year, right, to green up 10% of the production per capacity of steel, I calculate 1.25% of GDP growth will be there. The third engine of growth is consumption. consumption, according to my research, if you measure it properly, not official data. Okay, well, I can tell many stories of that, right? Official data relies upon household surveys, where our rich households refuse to cooperate with the National Bureau of Statistics. Only poor households cooperate because they get money by reporting their income and consumption. So in the end, our national data only reports the low consumption of households. Anyway, so consumption of share of GDP has been increasing since 2007. Now it's around 47, 46%. I think give us another 5 years, that ratio will go up as high as 50%. Right, gradually moving up to the US level, may never be the US level, but however, you know, 60% would do it. That will become a new engine of growth.
Yeah, Nick Lardy, foreign investment into China has been one of the engines in the past for growth. You see, one sees a lot of things happening that could be interpreted as favorable to foreign investment, companies looking to China to put more money in. At the same time, wage rates are rising. There's a different wage arbitrage calculation, labor cost arbitrage calculation undergoing. When you talk to companies, when you advise or speak with those who are interested in putting money into China, what are you telling them?
Well, my view is, going off of what David said, there's a big structural change underway. So any foreign investment, indeed any domestic investment, has to take into account the fact that this is not going to be largely in an investment-driven economy as it was for much of the past decade. It's going to be much more consumption-driven. That means the growth sectors are going to be particularly services, which follows from what David said. So I think there's a big sectoral change that companies have to take into account. So traditional industries are going to grow much more slowly, and new industries are going to arise. We see it in many internet businesses and so forth. So I think the landscape's dramatically changing. And foreign investment in China is not going up very rapidly these days. It's going up a little bit. It's still relatively large in absolute terms, but it's never really been very big in terms of a share of total investment. You know, foreign investment in China is a few percentage points of total investment. So most investment in China is domestic. The real contribution foreign companies make is more in technology and marketing and management and other kind of soft areas rather than the financing.
Yeah, talking about service investments, the U.S. competitive advantage against China in investment, in my view, perhaps are in the following sectors. Financial sector, very competitive. However, China is very careful with this because of stock market problem. Yeah, they are, most likely they will be very cautious in China, right? Second sector to be very competitive, your lawyers. Lawyers, New York City, right? Lawyers, okay, some of them are here, right? So, but again, there are issues there because Chinese law, we have a lawyer here. We have a Duke-trained lawyer, Dr. Gao, lawyer, right?
No longer one.
He drafted literally Chinese securities law for the stock markets. He's one of the architects of Chinese stock markets. We don't blame him for the free fall, okay?
Yeah. They took away all the sections that will cure the problem.
Internet service. Frankly speaking, U.S. is not that competitive. Amazon, frankly speaking, is struggling in China. Amazon.com, not making money. I don't think this is open. You know, this is open knowledge, right? I'm not revealing anything. Right? Anyway, so and consulting tricky. Okay, I'm not sure. McKinsey's. I'm not sure. Okay, I would bet they are equally competitive as some local ones. Okay. So this is the landscape of service investment.
Neither of the two economists picked up on this notion of a concern about deflation that Mr. Zheng added to his list of issues. Are you worried about that? And what's the chance of a deflationary trend in China having a contagion effect in the rest of Asia, perhaps globally?
I am not worried about deflation because deflation is an enemy, because usually it cuts in your wage rates, right? Japan faced inflation because the nominal wage is coming down. So I was told in Japan, husbands are having smaller amount of money in their jackets, in the pocket. The housewives are not giving them money, right? So they don't go drink after work. I was told. I read New York Times, okay, right? Your newspaper, okay. Anyway, in China, to the contrary, wage rates of blue-collar workers have been increasing, double digits, nominal, faster than GDP, because we're facing a shortage of blue-collar workers. A construction worker with 4 years of experience is earning much more than a graduate of Tsinghua University Finance Department. In 4 years, I'm not saying 10 years, right? In 4 years. So this is, so I don't worry too much about deflation.
Mr. Lardy?
Well, I gave my view on deflation. I think I tend to agree with David. And I don't think it's going to, I mean, obviously China has transmitted some deflation to the rest of the world because of slowdown in demand for certain commodities, iron ore and copper and a number of others that we could mention, has contributed significantly to this very continuous and sharp decline in commodity prices globally. It hasn't been the only factor, but it's been a big factor. But you know, if David's right that we're near the bottom of the U, you know, that factor will disappear. Remember, the overall, you know, the GDP deflator in China is still in slightly positive territory. This is not an economy with a big decline in prices as you measure it comprehensively by the GDP deflator.
And you see the U shape. You agree with that prognosis?
I think it's a possibility. I don't know what percentage I would put on it. A lot depends on whether or not this big pickup in sales that David mentioned really continues. In the first quarter, sales were down over a year ago, but you take the data for the first half, sales were up 10%, the property sales were up 10% in value terms and 20% in terms of area. So that's contributing to the decline in the inventory that David mentioned. I don't know if this spurt of sales in the second quarter is caused by some, you know, one-time factors or whether it will be continued. I'm a little more agnostic.
Well, I have a theory here about that part regarding the increase of real property prices. Because, you know, for most Chinese, they, you know, for them, we save a lot. And the money, where do we put the money in? You know, traditionally it was always in a bank, and now stock market or real estate. And a while ago, when people, everyone was investing in real estate, it was because real estate price was going up so fast. But then the stock market started coming up. People put it out and put money in the stock market. And now, this time, you know, in recent months, if you look at the real estate prices in most of the large cities, big cities, it's all coming back, and prices start to grow up again after so many months of stagnating or even going down. So now, what's this, this the drastic, the violent saving the market measure? I don't think many of the longer-term investors would try to stay in the market. So the money is probably going to come out and going back into the real estate market again. Mm. And that accounts for a big part of consumer price, because, you know, of course, you don't have that price, but you have the rent. And rent has been going up all the time for Beijing. Even during the whole past few years when real estate price is stagnant, rent still keep going up, just like the wage for blue-collar workers. So I think that's still a big factor. Mm. And so when people say wealth factor, that's something that you have to take into consideration.
The demographic picture of the whole country in terms of regional distribution is changing rapidly. When people are getting richer, of course, in comparison with 30 years ago. When people get rich in China, people do two things. Number one, they move to warmer cities. Warmer cities. They stay away from the cold cities near Russia's Far East, right? The northeastern part. Second, they move to large cities, especially young people. That's why in Beijing, as Dr. Gao just said, the rents have been increasing rapidly. In Shanghai, same thing. In Shenzhen, same thing. Right, so there's a tremendous structural change in the property market. So the first tier cities are still expanding in terms of construction of property investments. Some second tier cities where the climate is warm is increasing. Others are decreasing. So there's tremendous change. So I would argue this structural change in the property market is driving investments in China. So if you go to invest in China, watch very carefully the demographic change across locations.
Mr. Gao, we've talked about investment in China, investment into China. You used to run investment out of China into the rest of the world. I know that you're not president anymore, but given the trajectory that you set the CIC on, what does all of the activity in China now, the reform, the restructuring, the inward-looking
aspect of economic policy in China at the moment. What does that say about the CIC's activities and the momentum for investment abroad? Is that a critical part of the economic reform effort in China? Is it likely, do you think, to stabilize, to diminish as a result of the activities at home?
Well, I don't think that has that much to do with it. Because CIC was always, it was created, you know, when, from outside you say, oh, this is sovereign wealth fund, it sounds like a lot of money. But in China, it's sort of a marginalized organization, it seems to me, because we have over almost $4 trillion, and you only give us $20 billion. You know, that's a small pocket money. And then when we first started, every government ministry warned us not to come back. They said, OK, now you're out. You go out, invest there, don't take any money back. Every time I saw the, you know, Minister of Commerce and saw, you know, the minister in the NDRC in these places, said, don't come back. So for CIC, whatever happens in China, it only has a sort of marginal effect. But one thing does affect CIC tremendously, which is the policy in the reform of state-owned enterprises, that the top management people's compensation is coming down. And that comes to hunt CIC and then say, okay, you need to come down with your salary as well. Our salary, for the first two years, we had an order from the central government that our top management salary came down, but that affected only six people. But then, you know, gradually say, oh no, everyone else would have come down. Up until the time I left, we have been resisting. I said, no, absolutely not, because if that comes down now, we may as well just go home, because you know, nobody is going to be hired. But now that's still a major pushback from, I wouldn't say who, but various government agencies, that they want all these people who make ostensibly too much money, which is, you know, according to the market, our highest paid MDs would get probably 40-30% of the market in their comparable profession. But they say, well, this is way too high. This is much higher than the migrant workers. Of course it is. So that affects people, you know, their morale. And some people would leave just for that reason, because they are afraid that may affect their family welfare. But I hope that's a short-term thing. I hope eventually that will change.
So we see some deflation someplace in China. That's right. But let's go to questions, if we could. And if you could, tell us who you are, identify yourself, and just remember that this is on the record. Yes, please, right back here in the middle.
Jeff Schaefer, J.R. Schaefer Insight. Mr. Zheng talked about re-engagement of the U.S. and China on the bit, which he would even extend, on TPP accession by China, and even on a bilateral free trade agreement. Zhu Rongji used joining the WTO to drive reform in China for over quite a number of years. Is it likely that this kind of process, if it were to be activated, could help to energize the third plenum reform process in China? Or does it really not matter
pressure
for what happens in China?
A little bit of foreign pressure. Who'd like to answer? Mr. Li, do you want
to? It's hard this time around because the internet. In the internet, people say many things, and our leaders do read the internet. They are extremely savvy. They have teams of people summarizing the views of the internet. And these views in the internet do influence their policy, even though we don't have election, you know, election-based democracy. In terms of opinion, we are very democratic. And in the internet, you know the game, right? The radical views oftentimes are win the game, right? And unfortunately, the nationalistic views are much more favored or weighted in the internet. So this time around, using foreign pressure to push domestic changes would be very difficult.
Mr. Gao?
Well, I would have a similar view. This time around, the populist movement in China, the overall sentiment is such that people, every time you come out with anything, immediately it would be a circulation of articles, claims, usually not very logic and very, it's all sort of slogans saying that, okay, we're setting out now, we can't do that. And the problem is that the government sometimes doesn't listen to that. The government gets nervous about the popular sentiment. But overall, I think with, you know, Mr. Xi is a strong leader, and I hope he stays that way for a long time. And eventually, you know, he would have to bite the bullet, so to speak, and just, you know, shut up those people or just let them make noises and do something about it. But at present time, it sounds like it is a major problem.
Another question. Yes, right back here, holding up the piece of paper.
Fine. Yeah, there we go. Thank you. Dan Rosen with the Rhodium Group. Dr. Zheng and I think all the panelists pointed to very near-term additional reforms being on track that are very important to getting to China's positive outlook for GDP growth, 7% or so. Things like additional capital account opening, full liberalization of deposit interest rates. Given the experience with the ability to regulate capital markets over the past month, do you think there's been a change in thinking in the leadership about how competent and ready China is to oversee something like an opening of one's capital account to global capital markets?
Mr. Lardy?
Well, I certainly take, I have no inside information, obviously, but I think if you're talking about the top Chinese leadership in the financial sector, I don't think they've really changed their views, and I think they don't, I'm not sure, I don't think they're reading the lesson that we should slow down or put the brakes on financial reform. And in part, this is informed, this judgment is informed by, you know, what Governor Zhou has said. He has said repeatedly that China's capital account opening is going to be managed and gradual. And frequently he is quoted as, or is incorrectly quoted as saying that China's going to have a fully open or freely open capital account. I don't think that's what he has in mind at all. I think he has in mind a very gradual process in which there will still be quotas on most channels of flows, both inward and outward. And he may be wrong, but I think he believes that that can work. And so the failure of CSRC to regulate the market for equities, I don't think he would believe is a good reason to slow down on this kind of more general financial sector reform. But as I say, this is just my analysis. I have no near time insights into his thinking.
Just to go.
Well, I agree with you about the part about Governor Zhou's view, which I'm very familiar with, but the problem is that he has responsibility only for his part of the government. There are other government agencies which have their own views, and one of the problems that this so-called crash happened is exactly because of the non-cooperation of these different government agencies. So right now there's so much all these hoopla's about shutting down the financial derivatives market, shutting down financial futures, stopping all the short selling for 6 months. So, and people actually came out with all these articles saying that, oh, look at America, they shut down the market when this stock market crashed. So I had to, at first I was very determined not to say anything, but then when people asked me, I said, that's really nonsense. You know, they don't shut it down for 6 months. They shut it down for 1 minute, 5 minutes, an hour, okay? So you had to educate the market, but the regulators definitely would be influenced by that. And right now they have already put up all these orders for the market to stop functioning in certain pockets. That's going to take for some time, because in my experience in the past 20 some years in and out of regulators, every time we shut down something, it's all usually during a crisis time, and that's easy. You do it in 1 minute, but then it takes forever. One market was shut down 15 years ago, still not open yet. Why? Because every time when you open, everyone has to sign off, and if any one of them says, oh, I have some doubt about that, then you can't do it. So overall, macro side, I think we're still on that track. But the problem now is all in details. Chinese market is a lot more sophisticated today, and you have all these small pockets of things which incrementally will see the reform going forward. But now, one by one, they're stopping it just because of some crash.
Should the government have stayed out and just let the market correct?
No, I wouldn't say that. No, the government is already in. the problem is. So you can't stay out, but my proposal to the government is that the government form a committee and immediately start in, and within 3 months' time, come out with a proposal and say, this is the reason why it happened, and this is what we need to do. Because otherwise, people are going to be always wondering.
Yeah, let's get to more questions right here.
William Hasseltine, Access Health International. You didn't talk about healthcare at all. Healthcare has a potential to be a major source of investment in our economy. It's 17% of our GDP, maybe too much, but a lot. It has a major capacity for input from overseas, both in terms of capital and knowledge. So I wonder your thoughts about the importance of healthcare. And it also has the possibility, if people think they're going to get healthcare, of encouraging more consumption.
And more saving, right? People fear that they don't get health care. That's why the savings rate is so high. Who would like to?
Dr. Gao is much closer to retirement than I am, so he worries more. I didn't talk about that.
But you look rather robust.
Well, I constantly have to explain to people why I'm involved in all these neck-breaking extreme sports. I said, well, having worked for the Social Security Fund for so long, I'm determined to try to die quickly.
Keep it funded that way.
Well, joking aside, health care reform is a very major thing. It's one of two things that's constantly on the mind of not only the leadership, but really on all the masses. And we know, you go to, on any given day, you go to a hospital. You know, I constantly go to hospitals for my injuries and my shoulders, my leg. You know, I break my legs all the time. But when you go there, in one hospital in China, the number three hospital in Beijing, which is good for sports injuries, any given day, you have 3,000 people. It's like a supermarket. People are going everywhere. And the doctor's office are all way overworked. So I think the government is very keenly aware of that, and they're trying to do a lot of things to change this. So, I agree with you. This is a huge market, and we have to do something about it.
Mr. Zheng has a comment.
If China were to enter the TPP, would that help to implement the domestic reforms? I think that, in fact, it would have a big impact in promoting the implementation. Even reforms that were not written into the third plenary documents would be helped forward by the entrance into TPP, because the reforms that we've seen over the past 30 years have been largely promoted by China's integration into world trade frameworks.
So the importance of foreign pressure, gaiatsu, as they say in Japan, do you buy that, or is it not going to be a factor in what happens?
This comes back basically to Jeff Schaefer's question, and my answer to that question would have been yes. If we had an ambitious BIT, it could be a catalyst for change in China, particularly in the service sector, which should be the big driver of growth, but is one of the most closed sectors in China, or at least certain parts of it are. The reason that I'm cautious, and maybe again sharing David's view, is it's not clear what China is going to gain from a BIT. There was something very clear that China was going to gain from joining the WTO that allowed Zhu Rongji, or at least contributed to his ability to overcome a lot of opposition. And that was getting permanent normal trade relations in the US market. This was a huge challenge for China in the 80s and 90s. Every year they had to worry about whether or not they were going to get renewed for MFN status in the US market, which even then was the most important market. I don't see any immediate plum that China gains from formulating and agreeing to an ambitious BIT with the United States. Yes, in the long run there would be substantial gains, but the negotiators can't point to something that is as prized as that was, and so I think they have less leverage overcoming vested interests in certain sectors that are not interested in seeing more foreign competition.
Could
there,
you?
There is one thing though.
Yeah.
Next year, the sort of grace period for for the so-called market economy status is going to be gone, and many people there are very nervous about it. You know, one that means that by 2016, China would have to renegotiate with every one of these major countries about their recognition of China's market economy status. If they don't, let's say, then immediately, you know, our prices are going to be affected. And then immediately, many of these courts or their regulators that are going to treat China as a sort of non-market economy, and then they'll have a surrogate country to have a different price, then would be, you know, regarded as a dumping country. Or, you know, if that happens, then of course, it'd be a big issue. I think a lot of people in China are very much aware of that. And that may be a major, you know, we all know every time anything happens, oh, this is the Americans doing it. So let's sign a contract with Americans. And if Americans agree that we're a market economy, then we're fine, right?
So. Other questions? Yes, please, right here in the red.
Hi, thank you very much for joining us and sharing your comments today. My name is Neely Gilbert from Materin Capital Management. I was wondering if you would speak a little bit about Hong Kong. How important do you see the economic relationships between the mainland and Hong Kong today? And how do you see those economic ties influencing the political dynamic?
We have not talked about political reform in China. Can you have, I'm tagging on to your good question. Your question should be answered first, but we have not talked about political reform. Can you have economic reform without inevitably people wanting to be politically enfranchised as well? But anyways, let's go to Hong Kong first, and then if you would touch on politics. Mr. Lee?
The Hong Kong issue actually is a bit more complicated than just simply political reform. The Hong Kong issue is that over the past 15 years, the mainland policy towards Hong Kong is that we'll keep you, your business being prosperous. We'll send you tourists flooding your streets, right? Making the people on the street becoming inconvenient, compromise their life. However, business owners get the benefits, right? So, and also give your big business tycoons good deals to develop in mainland China. That kind of policy has been making the society more and more fragmented, right? The young generation feel very angered. They are not only becoming complaining about the streets becoming more crowded, they are also competing with mainland students who work much harder almost by definition because they're poorer, right? The mainland students are coming to Hong Kong, crowding out the Hong Kong students going to their own universities. I know this because I used to work in Hong Kong. So the young people are revolting against these kind of policies. So before talking about political reform, I think in Hong Kong, I think mainland policy, economic policy towards Hong Kong definitely will change, and it's changing now. And also let me add one more thing. The importance of Hong Kong is not Hong Kong per se, it's Taiwan. Because Hong Kong was held as a model for the future, for the potential solution of the cross-street relationship. So the central government has all interests, has all stakes in make sure Hong Kong is not only economically prosperous, but socially less disharmonious.
Is there a future for political reform in China, Mr. Lardy?
Depending on how you define political, really, I mean it. There are a lot of subtle changes in the political system. For example, 2 months ago, the Central Committee published a document about how to involve those non-Communist Party members in politics through the political consultative process. And that's regulation, that's party regulation, saying that at all levels of government, some positions, say out of 5 key positions, 1 must be reserved for non-Communist Party members. And also that says, for example, twice a year, a local government has to hold consultation meetings with non-party members. This is a very significant document. By the way, the Central Committee's documents, sometimes as a fact, can be more binding and more important than the legislation. Let's That's go. Why a person like Mr. Zheng is very important. He's drafting a lot of documents.
I can give you some examples of what I would regard as the progress on the political reform side, even though you know we don't want to say the word, because sometimes political reform is sort of regarded as being the effort of the Westerners trying to influence China into a more Westernized country.
Or diminish the Communist Party.
Exactly. So what we're doing, I think the Communist Party knows very well that it has to reform. And you know, it started from Deng Xiaoping, who said that we will start political reform. Even though we don't say it anymore, just look at several systems. Judicial reform. You know, the fourth plenum of the Party Congress was devoted totally to this part. And many people say, after the communique came out, many of my friends came to me and said, well, you're a lawyer. Aren't you disappointed at the document? I said, why? They said, well, just look at it. It all says the same thing. I said, no. You don't know how to read between the lines. In fact, we have been talking about the rule of law for the past 30 years. But today, the first time, I say, there are all these detailed things that you actually look at. It starts to cross this line beyond which you can't return. For instance, we always have this Communist Party group called Politics and Law Group, which is really a overwhelming czar of all the laws. The police, the courts, the procurator, they all come under that committee. But what they're basically saying is that, okay, now we want that committee to rise from every level of government, which you know starts from the township to the county, prefecture, province. Now they're raising it down to the provincial level. So the courts below the provincial level are all much more independent today than before. Because you know before, when you have the court and the party secretary there in that leading group, will always have something to say. And now they say, oh, well, you can't do that. And some people say, oh, that's not right because you know, the country, the People's Republic do it. I said, look, every province in China is about the size of one of the 10, 20 largest countries in the world. You can't just do that fast. So in that regard, I think we have already made progress.
Let's get to a couple more. We have 5 more minutes left. Yes, please, right over here.
Perhaps this is too simple a question. Mike Levin from a firm called Titan Steel. When China wanted to grow, China grew very quickly. Resources came together. Great improvements were made, like at Tsinghua University. The aluminum industry grew. The car industry grew. The steel industry grew. Everything happened very dramatically, very quickly, and made an impact on the entire world. Sitting and listening to you today, it sounds to me like change on the way down is very slow, very political, very mired in process. What happened to all the action on the way up and the slowness on the way down? This U that you're talking about could go on for years and years. And although only one of the major economic developments that you talked about was oversupply, oversupply won't change. The demand growth over the next few years in aluminum, in cars, in steel, in a lot of the other things that China has become major exporters of, won't eat up the excess capacity. It has to be blown up and destroyed and buried.
Mr. Lardy,
so that's a dramatic act that you could take. And I believe, by the way, if you take something like steel, that's my own industry, there's 300 million tons of too much capacity in China. Were that to be removed from world markets, the increase in global prices would more than pay for the unemployment of the 300,000 workers no longer employed.
So, Mr.
What do you
Lardy,
think?
Is the U going to be an L?
There are a lot of variables at play here. You know, determining what David described, the bottoming out. Will it be a few quarters, or could it be a few years, or even longer? I tend to think the dynamic is already in play. Consumption as a share of GDP is rising, even by the official data, which may understate it somewhat. It's been going up for 4 years. That's what's driving economic growth now. We're in this virtuous cycle where the service sector is the big driver of economic growth. It's been growing more rapidly than industry. Beginning in the second half of 2012. It's generating a lot more employment with a lower GDP growth, so the leadership is much more comfortable not having a rapid expansion of credit as they did back in 12 and 13. And I think that process will get more traction over time, and as David said, consumption share will rise further, and the structure will continue to change. And you know the steel thing is a little bit complicated. The 300 million tons of excess capacity, but it's not being used. They're not making 300 million tons that's going into inventory. They have the capacity to make 300 million more tons if the price were high enough, but it's not. And you know, more than two-thirds of the steel industry is private companies, and when demand falls, they cut production.
We have 1 minute left. Let's get one quick question, if we could. Very quickly, right here.
Bob Lifton, RM Power Systems. Mr. Zheng mentioned that China has now increased its patent production enormously. In the past, we were always concerned about the protection of intellectual property. Now that China has more of its own patents, do you think the protection of intellectual property will be enhanced?
Now that they have something to lose, yeah, are they going to protect other people's intellectual
That's
property?
That's the question.
As well. Who'd like to?
Yes, just to give you one example. There's already a court set up just for intellectual property rights protection in Beijing and also in Guangzhou as a sign. Let me quickly go back to the other question. The challenge today is not to grow, but how to grow cleanly, not only in terms of environment protection, but also in terms of politics. Cleaning up corruption and push for fast growth are very difficult to combine. So right now, cleaning up corruption, which in the short run is, frankly speaking, is becoming an impediment to a lot of reform programs because people want to be clean first before pushing for things. So that's why the big bottom might be there for quite some time.
Well, we're at the end of our hour. I just want to thank Mr. Jun, Mr. Lee, Mr. Lardy, Mr. Gao, the Council on Foreign Relations, and Tsinghua University. Thank you. Thank you.